Once again, good evening and welcome. My name is Elijah Gross. I'm the Director of Planning, Design, and Construction with Alexandria City Public Schools. And before we get started, I wanted to acknowledge a few school board and council members in the room. From City Council, we have Ms. Dale Pepper. Yes. With the school board, we have Mr. Christopher Lewis. Yes. And then we also have Mr. Bill Campbell. Also with us, I want to acknowledge a few members of the design review team with the school and with the city. We have myself. We also have Mr. Richard Jackson, who's Educational Facilities Director. We have our internal project manager, Mr. Paul May. He's around here somewhere. He's out there in the rear. We also have our Chief Operating Officer here, Mr. Clarence Stooks. And from the city, we have Mr. Ryan Price. We have Mr. Jeremy McPike, Mr. Jack Rowan, Ms. Donna Pellucci, and Ms. Margaret Orlando, and Mr. Adrian King. And these are, many of them are members of the design review team for this project. Oh, I'm sorry, a new board member, Rainey Gentry. So now we're very excited to come before you tonight with this update on the Patrick Henry project. There's been a lot of work in the background since we last came before the community. This is the first time you're actually going to be seeing some images formally that the architect has drawn up. So it's a very exciting time for us, and we have a lot of information to go through. We have our external project management team from Brelsford and Dunleavy, who's been the been the coordinators for many of the meetings with the advisory group, and they're also going to walk us through the presentation and most of this meeting. So without any further delay, I'm going to call up Mr. Mike Quadrino with Brelsford and Dunleavy.
Thank you very much, Elijah. Thank you. Okay, really quick agenda introductions. Have already occurred. We are going to do very quickly. I'm going to try and move very quickly here to get to the more interesting matter with our architects from Mosley Architects. But I will just do a little recap of project history, recap the community engagement process, go through what we've been calling our initial design considerations. That's a term that we've been trying to use consistently over these last few meetings. Talk about a lot of the things that are at the forefront of our mind throughout this initial design process. We'll also do a brief update on the traffic study. Then Mosley Architects will run through the current design options. And then we're going to go, we're going to do some live polling as part of this meeting. We're going to run through the questions that are going to be polled. We're going to give you all hand clickers to give answers to certain questions. And we're going to see the results actually right as you answer the questions up on the screen to get an initial feeling of what some of the feedback is from this room on some of the questions we're going to ask later on. And I'll mention now that that same polling questions is going to be posted in a survey format online on the project website starting tomorrow morning. So we'll remind you about that at the end. The polling questions, we're going to let you know what they are, but then what we're going to do is we're going to break up into seven breakout groups, and that's the numbers that Elijah mentioned earlier. So if you look at the agenda on your seat, does everyone have an agenda from sitting down? Does anybody not have an agenda? One over here. Okay, two over there. So we'll get you agendas right now, but you'll look at the very bottom of the agenda. You should see a number, one through seven. So when we do the breakout groups, we're going to refer to those numbers, and we're going to point you in the right direction over that way. And then we will wrap things up and talk about next steps. You'll see my comment here. We do ask, hold any questions. That's what the breakout groups are really for, is to each breakout group is going to be led by one of the members of the design review team that Elijah just mentioned. So And we anticipate that being about a 15-minute breakout period. So everyone will have 15 minutes to interact with a group that we think will be about 8 to 10 community members with an individual project team member to have a really in-depth discussion about what you see in these options, clarify any questions, talk amongst each other. And then before we go into the polling questions, we're going to have members of our project advisory group, who we'll introduce a little bit later on. There's going to be at least one advisory group member at each breakout session table who's then going to take a minute and just respond back to the whole group about some of the larger talking points that occurred at that breakout session table. So without further ado, a little bit of the project history and timeline. We do want to just provide full context for those who might be newer to the project, and it's also been about a month or two since the last big community meeting, so we just want to go over some of this material again. We do talk about two somewhat defining points in this project's history. There's years of planning and surveys, especially on the recreation side, that went into the planning effort on this project. But in June of last year, two specific actions occurred, one being the school board approving the construction of a new building for the Patrick Henry pre-K through 8 school building, and then on June 23rd, the City Council approving the Neighborhood Recreation Center approach for a new rec center, and we're going to talk a little bit about that in the very next slide. And then the rest is just some key milestones. In September of 2015, we were brought in as project managers. In January of 2016, we made an award to Mosley Architects. In February, they began developing schematic designs, and now we're in March, where we've just started that process, the development special use permit process. So these three options were submitted for official feedback from city reviewers as well, and we're gonna talk about how that all comes together in the process here in a little bit. Going forward, so in approximately 2 to 3 months, in June of 2016, we anticipate having a formal approval of the schematic design from the school board, and then use a public hearing for DSUP in the fall before construction begins in 2017 and goes to 2018. Very briefly, to touch on the neighborhood center approach for the recreation. As I mentioned, it's consistent with the City Council action that occurred back in June 2015. It will be approximately 18,000 square feet just for recreation space. So that's a rec center that is open throughout the day that is not used by the school children. Obviously, it adds indoor fitness space, it adds walking and running facilities. Most importantly, it expands the offerings for the recreation department for both youth and seniors, again, having that space during the day that the current rec center doesn't have, especially expands programming for the seniors, but then also accommodates the youth, especially with the after-school program. And that will occur in a shared usage format, so after school gets out, especially for the after-school program, it'd be a combination of centers within the spaces within the recreation center, as well as the school gym, multi-purpose room, and black box theater, which together come to about 11,000 square feet. So overall, in that shared use capacity, it comes to about 29 to 30,000 square feet. So just a little bit about the community engagement process and the different levels of input that are happening right now as we've been reviewing these three options for the last several weeks. You see in the middle is the design review team, which were the members that Elijah pointed out earlier. And that's a team that meets at minimum every other week, although these days it seems we're meeting all the time as we're getting different pieces of feedback from the community and from official city reviewers. There's also our community advisory group, who last met about 2 weeks ago. And if I could just ask, for those, the advisory group members, if you could just stand real quick, so we're known. So yeah, please give these folks a round of applause. They've been spending a lot of time with us, meeting 1 to 2 times in between these larger community meetings to let us know what they're hearing from their respective civic associations and different organizations that are represented on the advisory group. And all those meetings are open to the public too, so some of you have likely been there recently. And then ultimately the larger community, and that's why we're here tonight, is to start hearing formally from the larger community and get your feedback on where we are in the design process. And those same entities play into this image, which shows, you know, all the different involvement through the design process and who is weighing in on the different options and really the different aspects of these options. And we're going to talk a little bit when Bill gets up here about how, you know, when we look into the future, we don't see one of these options in its exact form as you see it today being what advances in the process. You know, we're looking to get feedback to try and combine as much as possible the best aspects of all the different options into one option. With the community, the advisory group, and in the upper right, I do want to point out the official reviewers from the city, so planning and zoning, transportation and environmental services, all those agencies are part of that formal DSUP permit review process. In fact, we just got some initial comments from them yesterday, haven't even really had a time to fully digest and talk as a design review team about them, but we are on schedule in terms of getting their comments as well. So, and one other image we want to come back to, this was an image that we showed probably, I'm going to say December of last year. It talks about the various stages of community engagement in this process. And so, you know, obviously we're right here in March, and you see about halfway through the text, early March, we talked about presenting the initial three site plan options with their design and their different design features for feedback, and that's exactly what we're doing here tonight. So we're very happy that we're staying consistent with this schedule, and we've moved along as planned. And you can see in some of the following months some of the next steps, and we'll talk about next steps at the very end of the meeting as well. So I want to take a minute, talk a little bit about the preliminary traffic study. Some of you may have already seen it. It's been posted to the project website on ACPS's website, but we did want to take a minute to talk about it. The first thing to stress is that it is very much preliminary in nature, and I definitely want to point that out because I think we talked about in some earlier meetings how in a typical project process, really, you wouldn't really start doing a traffic study until, you know, right about now, or maybe you would have started a few weeks ago, right as the architects get started and draw up some initial images like they have for us tonight. You would do a traffic study and then have a traffic consultant kind of weigh in on the three different options. But back in the fall, you know, knowing some of the concerns that came out of the feasibility study process, we said we were going to get a leg up on that process. And we started a traffic study, and traffic counts were taken back in the middle of November before the holiday season, because you're not allowed to take traffic counts at that time. And what we did ask the traffic consultant to do was evaluate those traffic counts towards the only real image we had at the time, which was back from the feasibility study, which, as many of you know, showed you know, kind of a loop that went around the building, went out on both Taney and Latham streets. But we asked them to look at that, but to also give us any feedback they could on whether or not traffic could be managed solely on Taney Avenue. And so that's what they did. You know, from their perspective, again, they're looking at the traffic counts and really formal numbers of cars that get backed up at intersections throughout the entire day. They found that both situations maintained what they call acceptable levels of service, and those are definitions that are, you know, kind of national federal standards that all cities, including the city of Alexandria, utilize when making decisions on and evaluating designs such as this. But they did say that in their opinion at the time, entries off of both streets would ease on-site traffic. So that was just a general comment that they made. And then their last comment was that busing should have separate access from cars for safety reasons. And that's actually something that is in the school's educational specifications that I believe is actually also a requirement from city planning and zoning. So there's really nothing new there. But what we do know is that what we now need to do is engage with that same traffic consultant and get their feedback on these three options as well, so we can see what works, what potentially doesn't work about these three options. We know most of you have seen these options. We know there's probably going to be a lot of discussion about traffic patterns when we break into the small groups, and we've purposely put, We've purposely put questions specific to traffic on the polling so that we can get that feedback both tonight and on the online survey. The last point here to make is that another thing that we do know is that the local fire department is going to require what they call an emergency vehicle easement, or an EVE, off of Latham Street to access the back of the building, because we know for a new construction, obviously the building is going to be tucked up more to the north of the site, and so to access all sides in a fire emergency, at a minimum, there needs to be that emergency vehicle easement. I do want to acknowledge we've gotten some emails from our advisory group members in the last few days who have read the traffic study, who have pointed out that it doesn't examine to the same level of detail some of the intersections that run along Latham Street, specifically to the north with Polk and Peacock Streets. And so that is something we are now taking a closer look at, because we agree it ought to be considered. We've spoken briefly with TNES about reviewing those intersections as well as our traffic consultant. So I say all this to say, you know, there's a lot of discussion going on between us as the project team members, Transportation and Engineering Services, and our traffic consultant in reviewing these options and really starting to kind of nail down and find out exactly what the impacts of the traffic are for these three options. Okay, I will now quickly also talk about our other initial design considerations before turning things over to Bill. And I'm going to try to go through these somewhat quickly, because I know this is a lot of text, a lot of material, and we want to get to the images. But just so you know, all the things that were on our mind and on the architect's mind in this initial design process, and we've had this list for about a month or two now, you know, one is obviously fulfilling the requirements of our site-specific program document. So that's obviously making sure it's got the right number of classrooms and the right square footage of cafeterias and gym spaces and everything like that. That's an obvious thing, and we know that all three of these options fulfill that. And that also goes for the recreation center, having those spaces. Where it gets a little more intricate is how the building itself connects to the outdoor spaces. So that's going to be something Bill's going to talk about, we're going to ask questions on. The site and traffic flows, you know, we know that's been a big concern from day one, and so Bill's going to talk a little bit about how these three options address that. We've talked a little bit about the traffic studies. LEED and sustainability, we've talked about that for a while and want to make sure we have environmentally friendly design. Quite frankly, at this stage, we feel that all three of these options are equal when it comes to LEED and sustainable design. We think they all lend themselves to good practices in terms of natural daylighting, stormwater management, and everything like that. We've been talking about neighborhood context, so scale and setbacks, knowing that there's single-story homes right across the street from the property, and how does the building relate to those. Stormwater management, we talked about a little bit with sustainability. Safe construction around operating facilities, I mean, that is clearly a must, and each one of these has different nuances when it comes to the operations of the school and the rec center to make construction happen. But clearly, obviously whatever we're going to do is going to have to, we're going to work with our construction company to make sure it's done in a very safe manner. It's just depending on which sort of option we go with could require different things when it comes to making that happen. Obviously, accommodating the existing indoor and outdoor recreation center offerings. We talked a little bit back about the neighborhood center and how the overall expansion of square footage gives the rec that capability, and all of these have the same amount of square footage when it comes to the rec center. So again, that's another one where we consider all things fairly equal. Maximizing natural open space areas on the site, and this is one that we heard a lot when we started engaging with the advisory group. So Bill's definitely going to talk about that in the three options. And then these three specifically are on their own side. These are three that we added to our list after our first two meetings with the advisory group based on things that they had heard throughout the community. Calling attention to the performing arts space in the school, knowing that Patrick Henry historically has had a very strong performing arts program. And again, that's something we think that'll be managed mostly on the interior by calling attention to those spaces, making them prominent. And again, we think at this stage, all three of these current options are fairly equal when it comes to lending themselves to that capability. People talked about, you know, having a proper focus on both the school and the rec center, making sure that neither one overshadowed the other. And so there are different aspects of these options that speak to that. And then last one, someone said, you know, let's make sure we remember the big picture, designing a facility which the community is proud of and uses often, because really that's ultimately what we're here for. So with that said, I'm going to turn it over to Bill Brown with Mosley. After Bill runs through things, I'm going to talk briefly about the polling questions that we're going to go through, and then we're going to just get ourselves organized in terms of going to the breakout sessions at the different tables, and we'll take it from there. Thanks, Bill.
Thank you, Mike. Yep, I need that. Well, thank you guys for allowing us to come out and share these three options with you tonight. And I just start to reiterate what Mike had said, is that we know that design is an iterative process. So the schemes that you see here are our exploration in different concepts and directions. And I think that's what we're here to talk about tonight, is which direction should we go. I do want to orient you with the site, and I think everybody's probably very familiar with the site. Here's Patrick Henry, Taney, here, North Latham. North Latham with the single family houses, then the apartment complexes off of North Howard. One of the things we sort of wanted to orient everyone is that there was a feasibility study done previously. This was prior to when we came on, and we know that some of the ideas evolved after the feasibility was complete. One of the desires was that, since there was no swing space, that what new construction and redevelopment of the site would require is that we don't land in the footprint of the existing building. Now, the other thing about the footprint of the existing building is that once we have built a new building, the logical place for us to have open green space is where the existing building was. So this is where the phasing of the project is really going to be critical. When we do bring a construction manager on, we'll be talking a lot about how to phase it, how to park it during the construction and the safety aspects. Some of the fixed design drivers are, some of them are kind of obvious, but I just want to reiterate, as we started a design process, that we had a pre-K-8 school, a recreation center with a neighborhood rec concept. There are adjacencies between the school and the rec center that are shared uses. We had to be mindful of that as we started to look at adjacencies. We have a budget to meet. We have a schedule to meet. As I said, the concept, I know in the feasibility study, some of the concepts were showing a separate building. It was determined that this should be a single building. It's the most efficient use of the site and of the operations of the building. And that we were targeting a LEED Silver Gold goal for environmental stewardship. So as you look at the site, we know that there's a pretty steep hill of about 20-foot difference in grade level. We know that the apartments here are much higher than the level of the property. Existing play fields, existing building. We know that, you know, walkers will be coming from different directions. We're looking at the sun path and all of the existing conditions that are really constraints on how we approach the design. Other considerations, I talked about the existing building. Mike obviously talked about the scale and context. So as I go through the different schemes, I'm going to talk a little about how each one sort of takes that into consideration a little bit differently. In terms of vehicular access, we, you know, best practices for school design is you always separate vehicular traffic to bus traffic. It's really critical. And you'll see that we've taken some different approaches. We actually, in each one of these, we've sort of tested out some ideas. And it's not to say that if we like the bus loop off of one way or the other way, some of them can be a little bit interchangeable, and I'll show that to you. Some of them are a pretty specific concept, and for that kind of scheme, there's, you know, the way it's shown is probably one of the only options. Mike did touch on the traffic consultant is just, you know, starting to look at some of these, but as we develop it, we're going to be informed by some of his advice, so that as the final schematic design hones down to a single direction, you know, we're going to take that into consideration. The phasing, you know, It was great because as we developed, we had a really good design charrette process, and we were working with the city folks and the school folks, and the concept of not demolishing any of the existing building was really reevaluated because it started to open up some possibilities when the rec folks said, well, you know, I guess as long as we get the gym before you demolish the existing gym, we can provide the same level of service. So it started to open up, as if you see, here's the existing gym. Well, if we had to build the building outside of that footprint, it really restricts us more. So it was a great conversation to have. And then it led us to even another concept that I'll share with you, where we looked at even what if we just built the rec center first and then demolished the other part. But safety and security during construction, our firm did T.C. Williams High School, and if you saw the construction photographs, you know, the buildings were pretty much side by side when we did it. And so we've done a lot of building replacements on the same site, and we work really well with the construction manager and taking their advice about how to, you know, phase things and do some work around the site. And I did talk about the pedestrian access. So our community engagement process has included working with the advisory group. We've come to a couple meetings. We shared these concepts and had some good discussion with them a couple weeks ago. We're here tonight to talk with the community. Some site-specific things that were drivers for us, which had a lot of community input, were the site-specific space requirement, the program for us. We've heard a lot about the Latham Street traffic. You know, so we've responded to that in our designs. The use or maximizing open, informal, usable green space. You know, we've come up with some concepts about how to approach what's in the program for play areas and green space, but then we try to keep in mind, well, how can we make use of all of the green space on site? And a real concept that was driven home was to make sure that while the architecture of this building will unify it, that each entity had a bit of a differentiation so that you knew, sort of on-site wayfinding is what we like to think of, that you knew that that was the entrance to the rec center and you knew that was the entrance to the school. So it was very important to us to recognize the fact that they needed to have specific identities. So what I'd like to do is sort of walk you through in sort of an overview of these three different approaches. I want to talk a little bit about the differences between them at sort of a 30,000 foot view, and then sort of the similarities between them. And then what I'll do is walk through each one, and then we'll, as Mike said, then we got the opportunity after sort of walking through them is to sit down in the groups and discuss them and have some questions asked and have some dialogue and conversation about them. And then if you want to double check something, we do have the boards in the back here that you'll be able to get up and go take a look at. So without further ado, one of the things that is similar between all of them is that we really try to push the new building as far north to the site so that we could maximize as much open space, be it for parking or the play fields or open green space, towards the Latham, the southern part of Latham. What you will see is that, just to let you know, here is the rec center in option A, the entry. Here is the entry for the school. So they're distinctly different, different drop-off areas. In option B, here is the entry for the school, and then here is the entry for the rec center. Again, the rec center is on a corner and on a corner, so we can sort of really develop a nice identity for it. On this option, here's the entry for the school and then the entry for the rec center. What's different, probably the distinguishing difference between these three concepts is really some of the phasing. And that's probably, I'm going to work backwards from C and talk a little bit about them and then end up in A. In C, we held to that concept that the existing building would stay and that we would build around it. And what that did is it sort of it opened up an area down here that we started to think of as the entry to the rec center as sort of a community plaza, sort of a, you know, once we demolish the existing building. We would be able to have some play area, a nice little plaza out in front of the gym, which is a shared use with the rec center. So on this one, the new construction does not fall within the footprint of the existing building. Now, in option B, we will have to demolish the gymnasium, the existing gymnasium rec center before building the rec center, but we build the gym first, and we'll build the rest of the building and the gym first. But then we would have to move the program into the gym and then demolish the existing rec center and build the new rec center. In option A, we would leave the rec center running along with the existing school, but when we build the new construction would be phased that we would build the rec center, the gymnasium, a lot of the larger type spaces of the new school, and not build this academic wing until such time as all this was up and running. The school would be running, but once we demolish the existing rec center, then we would build this portion of the school. So that's the difference in terms of the phasing. And when we sit down, you can start to look at the plans and understand that a little bit. The other difference between them is the massing and the scale and how it responds to the neighborhood. In option A, and what you'll be able to see a little bit better when we get to the massing plans, but I'll just sort of let you know that we have some of the lower one-story spaces towards the Latham side. Then we have the rec center and the gymnasium and the cafeteria multipurpose room, the black box and performing arts spaces, which are sort of a height and a half. But then as we go down, then we have a two-story part here that will have a second floor above that. And then this is a three-story academic wing, and it worked well with the grade levels. But the beauty of this is that this three-story academic wing is sort of more in relation to the grade difference here, and then these apartment buildings are four-story. So our idea was that we go from the residential single family, and it sort of steps up through the site. So that was our concept there. The massing of B and C are very similar. We have the one-and-a-half-story type spaces like the rec center and the gym, and it's pretty much similar here except that we slide the rec center over more to the center because we leave the existing there till the end. But the one-and-a-half-story spaces are both here, and then we will have what is a two-story academic wing. Just to sort of talk a little bit about the access for cars and buses. On option A, and we're showing three entries off of Taney. One would be a drop-off and parking for rec. One would be a drop kiss and ride for the school with parking, and then a bus loop along with access to services in the back. This also shows where we would have the EVE, which is the emergency egress. Here, we've got the drop-off for the rec center. We looked at putting parking back here, but if a fire truck comes down in any of these, we need a turnaround for the fire truck, but then this would be the bus drop-off in the front for the school. In each of these two schemes, we really wanted to try to develop a front yard, so we took the play field and aligned it on a north-south axis to be the front yard of the school. This is a little bit different. We had the bus loop in the back off of Latham, and then the drop-off for the rec in the park would be shared. So I'm going to go ahead a little quicker here. So here you can sort of see option A. I sort of walked you through this already. You can sort of see the massing that does step up. So this sort of gives you a sense of how that would work. The lower spaces, the one-story spaces, one and a half, two-story, and then three stories. We went up the side there. Option B, parking and staff parking in the back. Drop-off for the rec center here with parking, serving the front yard, as I like to call it, bus drop-off with visitor parking here, and you can see the massing of this scheme. Option C, this is the one that we had, the bus loop in off of Latham. And in these, is you can sort of maybe get a sense, is that we probably could bring buses off of Taney on this one or here, but we would have to adjust parking and the drop-off in the front of this one. And then this is the massing for C. Two-story, and then the two elements of the rec center, and then the entry to the school. So, in closing, just to sort of imagine, if you will, this bus loop could probably fit into here, and just have the you know, grasscrete and the curb cut for the emergency vehicle access. But this one was really developed with a bus loop that came off a Taney like this, so that would, you know, change to something else. It might be just parking. And the same could happen to some of these. So you can sort of get a sense that we were exploring the different ways to graphically relay what these different concepts are, but want to get, you know, some input and feedback from everyone to sort of recognize where we go from here.
You know, how important to you are these eight topics? So one, we talk about optimum access from the building to the exterior elements. So how safe and direct is the access from inside the building to the outdoor playfields and the playgrounds? Number two, the amount and the usability of the outdoor space. And when we say usability, you'll see each option is a little different in terms of how you know, how contiguous or how vast is that, how connected are the different open spaces. So we want to get feedback on that. Number three and four, self-explanatory, minimizing the impact to traffic on Taney, and then also minimizing the impact to traffic on North Latham. Number five, the building scale and setbacks, which you heard Bill talk a little bit. And again, so what we're going to do, we're going to ask you how important on a scale of 1 to 5 are each of these, and then we're going to ask you, out of the three options, A, B, and C, which one do you think does the best? So each question will be followed up by, in your opinion, which one do you think does the best? Six, separating parking entrances for recreation and school. Seven, promoting biking and walking to the building through safe access. And then number eight, ensuring that the school and recreation center both have a distinguishing physical presence. So we're going to ask you all to talk about the importance of those. We do want to point out a couple areas where you know, we're not polling questions, and I spoke to them a little bit earlier. We think, you know, all three are equal at this time. There's accommodating all the spaces listed in the program requirements, lead and sustainability, shared usage, because all of them are connected, and we know we can accomplish the securities needed to promote shared usage, showcasing the performing arts, and then providing separate driveway entrances for buses and schools. Connected to this very specific laptop that we got from the city's planning and zoning department, since they are the owners of the clickers. So we do ask, maybe some of you who are in the back, maybe come up a little closer to make sure we're within the radar limits of this piece of technology. Okay, we've tested it, great. So we're gonna run through the questions, you know, bear with us as a group as we get started. The first four questions are demographics questions. Which you don't have to answer, that's one of the options, but, you know, male, female, age range, so we'll kind of use those as a little bit of a warm-up, and then we'll go into these polling topics that we already mentioned and the different options. You know, just so you know, for the demographics, you know, we are interested to know just how well represented the entire community is, so it is helpful, but it is not absolutely imperative. Abudi, so let's...
Just a couple of things. If you've never done this before with these things, it's pretty straightforward. You know, you'll be able to hit the number associated with what your preference is, 1 through 5. It's pretty simple. If you want to change your mind, you can. The thing's going to record your last button that you push. So once we say everybody good, we're going to give you like a 1, 2, 3. We're going to the next question. Once we do that, it records your answer. So we'll check and make sure and look for a bunch of nodding heads before we move on. Okay, just to be careful on that. Okay, so you can change your mind, but once we say we've moved on, we're not going back.
Okay, let's. So that was the same, but this is not an actual slide, right? Okay, first question. What is your gender? Click a 1 for male, 2 for female, 3 if you prefer not to answer. We'll give a couple seconds. Everybody good? Yes? Okay. Here's the test. All right, here we go. Right now this room is 36% male, 58 female, 7 prefer not. Okay, we'll move on. What is your age range? 1 for 18 to 25, 2 for 26 to 55, 3 56 and over, 4 prefer not to answer. A couple seconds. Everybody good? Yeah. Okay. All right. Very good. Okay, this one's going to take just a minute to explain. Where do you live? Okay, and in the first, we're calling the immediate Patrick Henry area. Okay, and what we mean by that is refer to this map and the streets that are highlighted in yellow. Okay, this obviously being Taney right in front of the school, this being Latham, this being Peacock at the top, this one being Howard Street, and then we go one block in into, Mansfield Street. So if you feel like you live on the yellow streets, we're asked that you click 1. If you live elsewhere in the Patrick Henry and the Polk Elementary School District, some of you may realize that the current Patrick Henry District is really to the east of the school, and once you go directly west, it's currently the Polk District. So it's kind of the immediate area outside Patrick Henry between these boundaries. If you're east of 395, south of Seminary Road, north of Duke Street, and west of Gordon Street and St. Stephen's Road, in general, we ask that you click 2, 3 somewhere else in the city of Alexandria, and 4 possibly outside the city of Alexandria. Please start now. Everybody good? Yes? Okay. Okay, very good. Next question. What best describes your interest and participation in this project? Are you an advisory group member? Are you primarily parent guardian of a student who's either currently in the school or maybe within a year or two, or a few years? Are you an active recreation user, whether you're currently using the rec center or potentially you see yourself using the rec center in the future? Are you both a parent guardian and a recreation center user? Or do you consider yourself more of just a generally interested community member? 1 through 5. Please start now.
So you say we only click 1?
Only click 1. And so that's why we tried to combine for 4. So yeah, you know, Coach Rico, you're an advisory group member too. Whatever you most strongly identify with. If you're an advisory group member, we would ask you click 1. So, okay, everybody good? Great. Oh, very good mix. Great. Okay. All right. Now we're getting to the questions on the options. Okay. Number 1. How important to you is it that the design provide optimum access from inside the building to the exterior elements, meaning the fields and the playgrounds? And you can see our scale here, 1 to 5, unimportant, slightly important, somewhat important, very important, and then extremely important. Okay, so on a scale of 1 to 5, how important is this to you? Please start. Everybody good? Okay. Okay, very good. And then, Thinking about that same topic, the access from inside the building to the exterior elements, which of the options do you think, in your opinion, does the best? A, B, or C? Which does the best from connecting the inside to the outside? Everybody good? Okay. Hold on. Okay. That's right. You're right. We're getting to the trickier stuff now, so take a minute. Everybody good? Great. Okay. Option A. Okay. Next. How important is it that the design provides a great amount of outdoor spaces, such as the playing fields and playgrounds, which is also contiguous in layout, meaning that they're not, you know, chopped up by paving and parking and things like that? Scale of 1 to 5, same scale. Everybody good? Okay. All right. Got it? Then again, with the outdoor spaces being contiguous in nature, which does best? Option A, option B, option C. Which does best? In your opinion. I see a few still clicking. Everybody good? Okay. Okay. Next. How important is it to you that the design minimize the impact to traffic on Taney Avenue? And again, Taney Avenue is the one that runs along the bottom of each of these images. How important to you? Same scale, 1 to 5. Everybody good? Okay. 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 Then again, which of the three options best addresses this concern? Traffic on Taney Avenue, which is the one on the bottom of the image. A, B, or C? Everybody good? Did I hear no? Everybody good? Okay. Okay, a split between A and C, we see. Okay. How important is it that the design minimize the impact to traffic on should be North Latham Street, so we apologize for that. It runs along the west side of the stripe, the site, but it is North Latham Street, and it is labeled as such on the images. So we're talking about the road that runs along the left side of the property, North Latham Street. How important to you that the design minimize impact of traffic on that street? Same scale, 1 to 5. Everybody good? Okay. Okay. Next question. Which of the three options best addresses this concern? Minimizing the impact to North Latham Street, which is the road on the left side, option A, option B, option C. Which does the best of minimizing the impact to traffic on North Latham? Everybody good? Okay. Option A, the clear winner in that category. Okay. Next, how important is it that the new building be designed so it accommodates the scale of the existing neighborhood. You heard us talk about that a lot. Bill talked about some of the buildings that step up and things like that. Same scale, 1 to 5, how important is this to you? Yeah, that's a good point, Jay. And this is one where the 3D images probably, you know, help out the most to show how the buildings relate to their surroundings in the neighborhood. Everybody good? Okay. And then same, in your opinion, which of the three options best addresses this concern? I see one or two still. Everybody good? Everybody? Again, option A. Okay. 15, how important is it that the new facility have separate vehicle entrances for the rec center and the school parking lots? Same scale, 1 to 5. Have separate parking entrances for the rec and school. Everybody good? Okay. And then, which of the three options best addresses this concern of separate parking for the rec and school? A, B, C. Everybody good? Still no? Okay, another one with A, which we would have figured on that one. Okay, next question. How important is it that the design promotes biking and walking to the building through safe access? And, safe access to us who work on these projects, you know, a lot of time that does mean reducing the number of vehicular driveway entrances. Because those create areas where pedestrians and cars are crossing each other, and then separating vehicles from pedestrians on the site as much as possible, and so forth. How important to you, scale of 1 to 5? Everybody good? All right. Okay, a lot there. Okay. And then, same question. In your opinion, which of the three options best addresses this concern? Option A, option B, option C. Is everybody good? Okay. Okay, little split. Option A and C. Okay. Last question. Sorry, not the last question. Second to last question. How important is it that both the school and recreation center each have a distinguished physical presence on the site? Same scale, 1 to 5. School and rec center each have a distinguished physical presence on the site. Everybody good? Okay. Very important. Okay. And now this, okay, so last question. Officially, in your opinion, which of the three options best addresses this concern? Separate, a distinguishing physical presence for both the school and the rec center. Option A, option B, option C. I see folks looking. And I'll say for the last time tonight, everybody good? Looks like it. Okay, everybody? All right, option A. Okay. And I believe, so that is it. That is it for our polling. We'll talk briefly through, I know it's been a long night. Last thing I'll say about the polling, remember, it's going to be online through the project website. So tell your friends, tell your neighbors. They're going to answer the exact same questions in the exact same fashion. And that's a great point. Just leave the clickers on the chairs when you get up. Okay. I know if you can go to for the website, for the school website, Carolyn. Yeah, for the school website. They're looking to access the school website. They can get there by going to the ACPS website and clicking on facilities. So, okay. Folks, I'm going to go through last steps, but I know Principal Bynum wants to say something, so I'm going to turn the mic to her, and then we'll go through a wrap-up.
I just wanted to thank the Patrick Henry parents for coming and heeding the call. We really appreciate it. We know it's a late night. Spring break's coming soon, though. So I do want to thank you because your feedback is extremely important because we do have our babies here. Thank you.
Thank you, Principal Bynum. I know it's late, so if you want to get going, feel free to briefly touch base. Here are meetings that we have scheduled right now over the next 6 weeks, tonight being at the top. And then April 6th, we intend to come back and present the feedback from both tonight and the survey. I'm going to go quick. And I'll leave this here for those of you who are walking out. Next steps, we'll continue reviewing these options from the project team members and especially city reviewers. There is a project update presentation to City Council on the 29th. So please do note that. And then really, we're working up to the community meeting on April 6th to come back and tell you more about the direction we're going to be going in. Thank you all very much. Yeah.